Roger.
Get them all then. I know.
My phone.
Good, yeah.
You all right this morning?
Yeah. This may be hot, so.
Okay. I cannot do what a normal person takes for granted. I struggle with the loneliness from time to time because I recognize that most foolish evil thought is merely with a wife and kids, and sometimes I wonder, God has been gracious enough to let me have come early, and that really helps out my loneliness. When I struggle with loneliness, I remember and say to myself that Jesus is better. That basically what gets me to every day. I go to church on my own every Sunday in my electric wheelchair. I really enjoy that because I am a geeker at the 11:15 service. My favorite part is seeing all kinds of faces. That is such a joy because I recognize that the church is made up of all kinds of people. I don't have to listen to lies that since I am disabled, I'm not important. God made me who I am, and I was born with cerebral palsy, not because of an accident, but on purpose. When I think of on purpose, I say, oh man, how can I not worship God because He loves me that much to give me free peace so I can encourage the old body of the church and non-believers. It's actually been to me your tears, and I am very humble because not everybody gives the gift of realizing that. God gave me this life to not waste it, but lose it.
Do you see a man enslaved with a disability, or do you see a man enslaved to Christ? And it's an interesting thing to play this video after such an interesting parable. You might be not seeing the connection, but I want to encourage you. The parable, we see a money manager who's more of a money monster that uses his master's money to buy friends. And in this video, we see a man with a monster disability that uses his master's time that he's been given and his master's love to show others that they've been purchased by Jesus Christ. And so I want to encourage you with that. I was very excited to share this with you. If that's all I preached right there, that's it. You know, that grabbed me. So I want to ask you, are you focused more on using your time, talent, and treasure for yourself or for treasuring Christ and treasuring others that God has purchased? And I see in this man, he's treasuring Christ through his adversity. And so are you able to treasure Christ through the adversities that come your way, or do you make excuses? Do you make excuses? So what are you willing to sacrifice for to see others come to know Jesus? What are you willing to do? Well, it's great to see you guys. Thanks for being here. Always good to see you. Always great to worship together. We've been in the Gospel of Luke now. It feels like 10 years, but it's only been a half a year. But we've been in Luke a long time. And our plan is to finish Luke on Easter Sunday. So we're going to, on Good Friday, we'll have a service right here. We'll focus on Christ's crucifixion. And then on Easter Sunday, it'll be the capstone. We'll Resurrection Sunday finish Luke and then dive into a series I'm very excited about. The graphic is still being made for it, but we have a plan. It's a 12-week series called Family Discipleship. I just haven't been so excited for a series in a long time like I am this series. So single people, you can just take the next 12 weeks off. No, I'm kidding. It's that we called it family. I thought about calling it a parenting series, but this is family discipleship. And every single one of us, if you're divorced or you're a widow or you're single or you've been married and your kids are out of the house, you're an empty nester, we are the family of God. In fact, you think of church, what is it? A family. And so we all have a responsibility. So Family Discipleship Series, that's going to be kicking off right after Easter Sunday. So be praying for that. Just to remind you, as we jump back into Luke, just kind of looking at a 10,000-foot view of this incredible gospel, we see that Luke's intent is made manifest in Luke 1 and verse 4. We can see it up on the screen. Here it is. That... hello, Siri, whatever that was. You may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. That you may have certainty. Very interesting. I don't normally work with a laptop in bed. In fact, never. I mean, like maybe twice a year that I do that. I really try to keep work at home and that sort of thing. But my wife is it's just one of those days. This is a couple weeks ago. I was working on this sermon. And Laura had something to do, and so I was like, okay, I'll work on the sermon. And I just I came to tears on this verse. This verse moved me to tears. One word, certainty. I want to see if it does anything to you. And again, I almost don't want to preach. I just want to just like let it awkward pause. Does that move you to tears? Why on earth would that move me to tears? And I forgot to tell you this. I got really mad first. I was glad my wife like went downstairs to get some milk or something. And I was just like huffing and puffing. And I read this and I got really angry first. Anger is not a sin. We need to preach that for a while, because a lot of times we think, oh, anger's bad. You can't be angry. But the Bible says, be angry, but do not sin, right? And so there was this, hopefully, righteous anger that just came upon me of just friends and family and loved ones that don't have a certainty. And that began to well up in me, this anger that they bought into, and an anger from the enemy that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And if the enemy doesn't make you angry on the devastation that he is and the deception that he has done to so many around you, and you're just like, well, whatever, then, man, I pray for the Holy Spirit to prick your heart. And that's what happened. I went from anger to, I was moved just by God's grace that he's so faithful. Even when we're faithless, even when others are faithless, we see God move over and over again. I was encouraged talking to a friend yesterday. He just telling me he's been going after a family member for 30 years. And just recently, they're like, hey, can I come to church with you? I mean, just amazing. And I was just like, yes, this is what it's all about. So again, this word certainty is a big deal. And it's key. What is certainty coupled with? The answer, faith. Faith. The things that you've been taught, that you would have a certainty, that your faith would be certain, not like a wave blown about by the wind, but certain, that is strong, that is resolved, that is unwavering, that is unchanging, a certainty about who Jesus Christ is and what he has done for you. The church is not about moralistic deism, that it's behavior modification. That's religion. Religion can whip you into shape real quick, right? A drill sergeant can whip you into shape real quick. Stop it. You will stop doing that, right? I mean, that's what religion does. Where Jesus wants to change our heart through the Holy Spirit, wants to melt our heart of stone, put in his Spirit, breathe life into us, where all of a sudden when you're ready in a rage against your kid or with your spouse, or you feel this, it's not a righteous anger, it begins to well up and you feel this monster inside. That, see, behavior modification, and the world can't change that, but the Spirit can quiet that. And just like he can quiet a storm, amen? So good to think about what God can do. And so this is Luke's thesis, all right? Oh, man. I feel like a VeggieTales episode, leeks. Or asparagus. All right. But Luke's aim and his thesis, not just for this book, but for our entire lives, is that we wouldn't have a flippant, mamby-pamby, whatever, feel-good religion, but a certainty and an anchoring in Jesus Christ. We see in that video that man in the chair, he's bound to a chair, but I see a man bound to Christ. And so when the world looks at you, do they see you like a wave tossed to and fro, or are someone that is certain in Christ? Something that's so important to remember, Christ isn't just a good teacher and a good carpenter. He's so much more than that. He is our glorious God that has provided the way to remove us and to rescue us and to save us from a stingy, hoarding kind of lifestyle, an empty, grumpy, bitter lifestyle. He is a patient and enduring lamb, but also a lion that will have his vengeance against the ungodly that reject him. If you're not, but not just against the ungodly, but against the enemy. I'm thankful that we have a lion on our side, not just a lamb to quiet our heart and to cover us with his blood, but a lion that faces the attacks of the enemy. We have a lion on our side. He's not against us if we are covered in the lamb's blood. All right. So again, I wrote this down when I was preaching this in the jail, that your certainty, it's not just like, well, you know, I'm just not certain. Should I have kettle corn or caramel corn? What should we watch on Netflix? Hoarders or a little Survivor episode? I'm just not certain. What do you want to do? It's not like that, right? And so if you are like that, like what should we watch on Netflix tonight, or what should we eat, kettle corn or caramel corn? If you're like that and you apply that perspective to your faith in Christ, like, hey, do you want to, do you feel like worshiping Jesus today? I don't know. Let's think about it. Or are you resolved? If you are uncertain, you are vulnerable. I want you to maybe write that word down, vulnerable, for the attacks that will come. Write that down, vulnerable. You will be vulnerable to the attacks and the enemy that will come, and they will come. When I think of dear friends and family that have been sucker punched by this world's liberal agenda, that hates Jesus, hates Christianity, unless, of course, it's like, oh, we got this great gospel singer that we can highlight for 5 minutes during a Grammy or Oscar or something like that. Like, okay, then it's okay for just a quick little, and then we're done. Button that up. And that's the world, isn't it? It's the world. So again, why do we need this passage? I want to dive into it. We are here. We can see it up on the screen. We are tempted to chase after materialism and miss out on storing up treasures in heaven. What's the passage's answer? Since Christ has paid for our eternity, this is amazing. He's paid for it. Bought and paid for it. Like if I told you, hey, got a 10-day cruise and then a flight to the Bahamas and then Disney World after that. And then, I don't know, I'm trying to think of what, and then the Virgin Islands, and it's all paid for. I mean, you could have it for 2 months. Make it 3 months. You know what? 6 months of vacation pales in comparison to this trip that's been paid for, and it's eternal, it's never ending to know him. So since it's been paid for, our eternity has been paid for, let us spend our time, talent, and treasure now while on this earth to help others find the way to eternity. I don't know why the word now is not in there. It's supposed to. Now, let's spend it now for him and for what's coming later. Are you understanding that? So important. Matthew 6:20, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. I mean, what do you do with the wedding dress? This is we still have it. I look at it and I'm just like, wow, honey, this is amazing. It brings back memories. You'll see it in the closet, but it's protected, right? It's covered because you don't want the moth to destroy. Do you know what covers us? We are the bride of Christ. We're given gowns of righteousness, right? We come into this world naked, and you got to leave this world naked. You've always heard that. That's a lie. You come into this world naked, and you leave this world clothed in righteousness. Isn't that great? The Lord gave me that. It was cool. I was just like, because I was trying to make a point, like we come into this world naked and we leave this world naked. That was in my notes. And then the Lord's like, hello, McFly. No, he didn't say it, but that's wrong. We leave this world clothed in righteousness. That's amazing. And so because of that, we want to be focused with our money. We want to not put money at the bottom of our budgets, but at the top, and have it be focused. So many churches or even so many on the tele-evangelists, it's like, hey, just call the number on your screen and send a check, send a money order, and then you'll be healed. Just buy this sweaty hanky and the sweat will, as soon as it comes in the mail, UPS will do same day shipping. The sweaty hanky will still be wet, and as soon as it touches you, you will stink. No, they'll say like, and you'll be healed. You know, just call the number on your screen. And if you're not healthy, wealthy, and wise, it's because you don't have enough faith. You know, man, it's dangerous. It's dangerous. Now, again, you can't outgive God. So many times I've given to God, and then he outgives me every single time. You cannot outgive him. It's just some televangelists take that too far. They take the prosperity gospel too far, and it becomes a false gospel. We want to always rest in Christ. We want to be focused with our money, not to earn something, not like, oh, I want this, so I'm going to do this, but to go, man, I'm thankful out of what Jesus has done. He's so generous, so I want to be focused with my money. I want to be focused with my time. Yeah, get those calendars out. Are you focused with your time? In fact, it was so beautiful. We tucked the kids in, and I sat down with my wife, and you know how I kicked off the sermon with the money monster and then the monster disability? That was all talking with my wife. It didn't happen in the office. We wanted to watch Netflix. It was, and we did later. I'm going to be honest. We did. But it was so I could just feel the Lord's pleasure in my heart. I mean, just like, you're sharpening your wife and she's sharpening you. The church is going to benefit and you're being blessed. And because you're strategic, you're actually making this a point, not just in your office by yourself, but with your family. And man, I'll tell you what, you can feel the Lord's pleasure, but you have to be strategic. If you don't plan, you plan to fail. I told my wife ahead of time, like, hey, I really want to talk to you about the message. Is that cool? Yeah, she perked up. I was like, really? Like, it's not going to be boring? Like, really? You want to talk about the sermon? Like, how many of you, if I called you, was like, hey, I want to talk about the sermon before. Yay, let's talk for an hour. This sounds fun, right? Let me just hit pause on that. That just sounds great. I'm going to kick my feet up. Yeah. And yet, that's what we should have, that attitude, right? You think like only the study nerds that want to, you know, like only, the, you know, that's just, they're weird. It's like the Holy Spirit does that. When we begin to talk about the things of God and we get focused with our money, get focused with our time, and be strategic in our conversations that we have with our spouses, or if you're single, with your roommates, with your neighbors, with your coworkers, with your children, be strategic. In fact, I got a Honda change, or a Honda change. I was at the Honda, and I took my kids, and we were strategic. Like, who wants to take three kids to the Honda dealership? You're without a car for an hour, three kids. It was one of the best times I've had with my children in a long time. Got the stroller, put my nine-year-old in the stroller. No, I did not. Thought about it. Just walked down to Zips. I feel like this is a commercial. Zips, Honda, yay. All right, that's not what I'm trying to do. They're both great establishments, but while it was being worked on, took the kids down to Zips to get them a milkshake. They were like, yes. My belly was like, yes. All right, and so we're going down, and I'm like thinking about the sermon, be strategic. Nothing's coming out. I'm just like, hey, how's your day going? Good. How are you doing? Good, Daddy. Milkshake, milkshake, milkshake. I mean, that's what the kids are doing, right? Milkshake, milkshake. And I'm like, so. And I'm like, Holy Spirit, help me. I'm a deadbeat dad right now. I can't talk. I'm trying to converse. All that's coming out is milkshake, 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 right? Is that ever happened to you guys? And so, it's amazing. The Holy Spirit was, I just felt, flooded me with something so simple. Like, what do you guys see in the clouds? And we just watched Peter Pan, so they're like, Captain Pan, there's a ship right there in the clouds. I'm like, you know what? I can see it. We had the most, we just stopped. All of a sudden, it wasn't just a quick, what do you see in the clouds? And then we started talking about God. Isn't it amazing that God has, and you just start talking about clouds, but you have to, instead of just going, I don't have nothing to talk about to the kids, milkshake, milkshake, but you start going, Lord, help me to not be that dad that doesn't know how to talk to my kids. If you're like that dad, you're a dad like, so am I. I'm with you. It's hard sometimes to have those conversations. But I'll tell you, it was my wife going, hey, take the kids, stroller. I blessed her. She blessed me. Good father time. And then we were blessed by the Spirit in conversation. So be strategic. I want to get back to money just for a second and hide behind Dave Ramsey so you don't get mad at me. But Dave Ramsey says something. You've probably heard about it. He says, and he proves it, Jesus talks about money more than love in this book. Because money is what we tend to love. In fact, I can get away with just about anything except, you know, talking about, I could talk about milkshakes, I could talk about this or that. You talk about money, woo, we start sitting up and just getting a little perky and like, what's he talking about? It's interesting that the parable of the prodigal son is strategically placed by Luke in this parable, this very interesting parable about this money monster, money manager, shrewd dude, this rascally rabbit of a guy, right? And it's right after the prodigal son. Look up the Greek word used for prodigal, and what does it mean? Siri can help you. It means wasteful. Isn't that interesting? Prodigal. Again, I come back to the guy in the wheelchair with the disability. what did he say? In fact, I was like, oh no, I'm going to cry again. I was backstage. I've already wept, you know, watching this video, right? That's why there's Kleenex, you know, strategic for this Sunday, right? And the thing that got me was when he talked about he didn't want to waste it. Did that get you guys too? And then when he goes, Jesus has given me this so I can give others Jesus, I'm just like, ah. And so what has Jesus given you, and how are you using it? The prodigal son was wasteful at first and until he met the grace of the Father that welcomed him back. Powerful story. If you missed that, go back and check it out on crossviewcommunity.com. The other thing in here, we see this money monster, this money manager that's wasteful with what his boss has given him. And we see it here, verse 2, check it out. So the employer called him in. You guys ever been called in by your boss? Oh, this is awkward. No one? Come on. I don't ask rhetorical questions. You've been called in? Yeah, a couple of you guys have been called in. How'd that go? Is that fun? Some of you are like, well, I told him what to do. I told him. Oh, really? You guys ever exaggerated how it went with your boss? Like you get home and you're like, yeah, it didn't go so good, but I told him. And then your wife's like, really? And you're like, well, you can imagine. Oh, I told him. You know what I'm saying? And so this money, he calls him in and he said, what's this I hear about you? Get your report. Somebody say report, say it out loud. Report, because we're going to come back to that. Get your report in order because you are going to be fired. Oh, man. All right, he's like, wait, come on. What? I have no choice but to tell you, you're fired, right? The Greek word used for report, I had you say that out loud. Here's why. It's the same verb used for the word diablo, to describe diablo. And diablo is the devil, and the devil means Satan? No, it's Satine. No, it means the slanderer, or the accuser of the brethren. So you think of a court of law, there's a defense attorney and a prosecuting attorney. Prosecuting attorneys are very, very important. But in this case, a prosecuting attorney in the court of heaven is seen in a negative way because he's the accuser of the brethren. Now, we, in a sense, are going to be prosecutors of the angels. Did you guys know that we're going to judge the angels? That's for another time, another sermon. You're going to have to do your research on that. So again, prosecuting is not always a negative thing, but when it comes to coming after the church, we see Satan takes this role of slander, and so he goes after the church. He goes after the bride. He wants to slander it. And in this case, we see this money manager, this money monster, in a sense, is slandering his boss's name. So if you want to put it succinctly, here's what it is. He was bad with money, and he was bad with his mouth. Write that down. He was bad with money, and he was bad with his mouth. Okay, there you go. Now you got it. This parable was very weird. In fact, I want to encourage you, read this out of the King James Version. And again, nothing, I'm not dissing on you. Some of you King Jimmies that love the King James or even the New King James. New King James does not even help you on this. This parable is so strange. In fact, I on purpose put it out of the NLT translation because to help you guys, to help me. And it is one of the strangest parables, stories in all of the Bible. I mean, there's some strange stories in the Bible, but this one is strange. It doesn't mean we avoid it. This one we want to lean into and lean into Christ and say, help us understand this. This is very strange. So let's back up a little bit. Again, this manager in the parable knows he's going to soon be fired. So I want you to understand something. You got the boss and you got this money manager. Is everyone understanding the hierarchy? The money manager is more like a money monster. He's bad with his mouth, bad with his money. This guy's money. So the boss calls him in, says, get your report in order. And when he's using that word report, the Greek of that is, you are talking bad about me. I want to hear what you've been saying about me, and I want to hear and see on an Excel spreadsheet, because they had this back then, what you've been doing, right? And so what does the guy do? When he hears this, he's like, I got a little bit of time. I'm going to steal the stapler. And I'm going to steal the, you know, he's like, what can I take? You ever see? I'm going to slash the boss's tires. He's giving me time. Woo, here we go. A quick side note, I find it incredible that the gentleman, the boss, doesn't fire him instantly, but actually essentially gives him 2 weeks' notice. It's a reverse of what typically happens. Normally you come to your boss and you say, hey, I just want to give you 2 weeks' notice. I found another job. And then normally if the boss is in that situation, he doesn't go, hey, I'm giving you 2 weeks' notice, fires you on the spot. So that's kind of interesting. And so this rascal of a manager goes around to his boss's clients and makes deals with them so that later, when he doesn't have a job, he can essentially couch surf. Be like, hey, remember that time I cut things in half, made a little deal for you? Can I sleep on the couch? Please let me sleep in your bed. You know, like one of those, like, just please let me come in. Please let me have another. I just want a Hot Pocket and a jalapeno popper. That's all I want. And then we see Luke 16:5-6. It says, so he invited each person who owed money to his employer to come and discuss the situation. And so he asked the first one, how much do you owe my boss, essentially? And he just cuts it in half. But again, I mean, what a deal. This is so nice. But there's ulterior motives. Today is no different. People scheme today to secure their future, don't they? It's instead of every man for himself, it's every scoundrel for himself. And in our story, we see it again. I owe him 1,000 bushels of wheat, was the reply. Here, the manager says, take the bill, change it to 800 bushels. We got oil, we got wheat. Sounds like the game Settlers of Catan or like Monopoly. This is not a game. This is not Monopoly money. This guy is cheating his boss of real money. And then here's the lesson. Verse 9, again, out of the NLT translation, is the only translation that will spell out the lesson like this. And again, I'm not endorsing that translation over another, but just for this parable, this is a really helpful translation. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. That's the lesson. The video, the guy with the cerebral palsy, use the situation that you're in to help purchase friends for eternity. Now, early on, the Catholic Church came up with the thing, and the Catholic Church does not endorse this anymore, by the way, but it was called indulgences, where it's like purchase friends for eternity. Jesus, in a sense, he's saying something so different, but he's saying purchase friends for eternity, but don't do it in the way like, oh, let me get my billfold. It's like, show them that they've been purchased. Be hospitable. Be inviting. Be willing to move to Haiti. I saw something on Facebook of this couple I can't wait to meet that moved to Haiti, right? I mean, they got everything taken care of here at home. They have 4 children. They on purpose purchase 2 children with Down syndrome. You know, nowadays, in the aim of convenience, we like, oh, that child, I saw the ultrasound, the child has Down syndrome, let's flush that away, let's get rid of that. That's what, so in America, we've killed so many out of the God of convenience. Isn't that interesting? You know, this couple just pricked my heart that they were willing to purchase friends for eternity, literally purchase these 2, adopt these 2 children. Powerful. What are you willing to do? How are you? Are you with your time? Are you going to purchase with your time and go after? Let me read it again. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Then when your possessions are gone, they will welcome you to an eternal home. What does this mean when your possessions are gone? I believe the text explains itself. It means the context is, ready? Death. Death. Because we see it proven in the end of verse 9. It says, they will welcome you to an eternal home. Can that happen on this earth? Can your friends welcome you to an eternal home on this earth? No, they cannot. So this is all about eternity. So Jesus is essentially saying you need to be at least as shrewd as the people in the world, but in a different sense. As the worship team joins us, Jesus is using an old rabbinic approach. Rabbinic is short for a tense for rabbi. That means teacher. He's using an old rabbinic approach where you go from lesser to greater. Are you listening? Lesser to greater. So take this principle that you got here, but apply it in a much better way. Apply it in a better way. So if the perverted, wicked sons of this age use their this every imaginable approach to secure things up for themselves, shouldn't you be careful how you act in regard to yours and others' eternal future? And so should Christians have ulterior motives in their dealings with others? I think our motive should always be, we should have the ulterior motive of love, right? That's our, well, why are you doing this? Because I love you. That's an ulterior motive. Yes, it is. This is supposed to be a business deal. That's it. You have an ulterior motive. That is correct. I love you. So our ulterior motive should always be not to couch surf on someone, you know, like, I'm doing this. I scratch your back, you scratch my back. I think our motive should always be to love people with God's love and look for gospel opportunities. I want to share a story that later just pricked my heart. In the moment, it was a little odd. I was in the Benton County Jail for ministry, but just want to make that clear. All right. I was in there, and sometimes I get so used to talking about jail that, like, my wife reminds me, you didn't say ministry. If someone was new to the church, they think, interesting, okay, pray for Josh. He was in there. But, you know, I was in there preaching this sermon in particular, and this gentleman, right when I was talking about this, he raises his hand, and he says, you know, it's interesting, I thought it was kind of strange that I did this, but I gave, you know, like you're allotted a certain amount of dessert in the Benton County Jail. And I've come in there, guys, and again, I love the people at Benton County Jail. I love the faculty. They're incredible there. But I'll see periodically it's a TV tray. Like you think of Lunch Lady, remember Adam Sandler, Sloppy Joe, Sloppy Joe. Like, right? It looks like, yeah, I don't want to say anything negative, but it's just, don't think dessert. I'm going to talk about cake here in a second, and don't think like, oh, they're spoiled in there. No. Like Top Ramen is like Thanksgiving, right? So anyways, this gentleman, I know I'm taking a long time. I'll hit this real quick. He goes, I gave my cake. Are you listening? I gave my cake to a friend so he would come to listen to you preach. If you remember anything from the sermon, it's maybe this strange example that this guy was like, I want you, if I give you my cake, will you come? Will you come listen? Now, if you think, oh, Pastor Josh is instructing parents to bribe their kids to come, that's not what I'm saying. You know, don't think bribery. That's a negative word. But I'm just, the heart, he's just like, man, I'll give you, do you want my cake? Like, please, just give him a chance. Just come in for a little bit. And you'll see people, they'll come in, because I always start leading worship, you know, Johnny Cash style, Folsom Prison. No, but I'm playing in there, and they'll usually stay in there. But as soon as I start, some of you got that joke. Okay, I'll start preaching. They like the music, but then they're gone as soon as I'm done preaching. But at least, hey, the cake got them there for a little bit, got them in the door. Now, they didn't stay, right? Again, if you catch a people with a gimmick, you got to keep them with a gimmick. But if they're caught with the gospel, they're there for eternity. They're there for eternity. But you can give a piece of cake up. You can do it. I mean, like, what are you willing to do with your time, talent, and treasure so others can hear about Christ? We see in Acts 2, I want you to write this down, homework assignment, Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 40 to 50, about, that's 10 verses, homework assignment. If you're wondering, what is gospel community? What is this? Is it just a cute little small group that sings Kumbaya, has spaghetti, and then, you know, does a couple verses, see you next week? No. Look at Acts 2. Again, that's another sermon for another time, but it's actually 42 through 47 if you want the exact. It's so powerful. That's a picture of the church where, yes, they even sold their possessions. Man, if you need something and I don't have the money to help you, and I have a discerning spirit to see you're not trying to be a master manipulator and take advantage, but you're really hurting. Man, not just me, but others in the group are going to step up, rise up, and if they need to sell some possessions to help them. I've literally heard of gospel communities that have done this. I'd love to say it's happened in our church. It hasn't happened in our church yet. It's intense. But where they started with one couple and then the next person, and they just moved around. The entire group was debt-free in 2 years because they applied this principle. You're like, that sounds like a cult. That's weird. I'm not saying that, but just listen to the Holy Spirit. Let him guide you and direct you, and be willing to let the Spirit stretch you instead of just that monthly tithe check. Well, it's that time of month, got to write the check. But God, Lord, what do you want? There's above and beyond. What do you want me to do? Do you want us to adopt some kids from China with some disabilities? Do you want us here in America? We got the foster care system. Do you want us to adopt? Do you want us to get into gospel community? I've heard of people strategically moving to do community with people, or moving their gym membership so they can start going after people together. Like, what if we reoriented and restructured our rhythms in our life to bring glory to God? It'd be incredible. I'm going to close with this. Colossians 4, 5 through 6, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Let's pray.